a great, great pleasure to have Nasiruddin Shahji with us today. It's a major landmark for us. It's our fifth edition, and we really, really welcome you very warmly. Thank you, Rajiv Masan, for having a conversation and being here for us this year. As you all know, Rajiv Masan is at CNN IBN. He's been a journalist a long time, writing about films. We all know his show. And, you know, it's a pleasure.
Thank you.
All you for us to have you here.
You know, it's a bit odd, and I think he'll agree. It's a bit odd to praise someone in their presence.
Yeah, I don't mind though.
And frankly, what can you say about this gentleman that hasn't been said already? What I will say is this: you know, in an industry where actors take great pride in talking about just how much work they put into their performance, and the fact that they want to show you. You know, they want you to see themselves. They want you to see them flex every muscle, every sinew, while delivering that performance. It's just such a joy to watch a man who makes every performance seem so effortless, as it should be.
Thank you.
It's just such a great pleasure to watch Nasir Saab. Nasir Saab, on Friday night, literally hours before you took a flight to come to Dharamshala, you were performing with the family, with your wife Ratna and with your three kids, Imad, Vivan and Kiva. You performed a production of Riding Madly Off in All Directions. What was that like working with all of them? I read somewhere that you said that they're better actors than they project, but you're gentler in your direction.
They take a lot of things for granted, for one thing, and it's different, I think, working with your own children than working with a group of students, because there's also the personal relationship that's involved. So I guess I've learned a little more patience by directing my children. But they're all good actors, and they all love acting. They don't realize, however, the degree of discipline that's required if you wish to be really good. I guess they'll learn with time.
Does that bring you closer as a family, as a unit?
Oh yes. Together? Yeah, we end up spending a lot more time together than we did. Though we're not estranged by any means, though Kiva and Imad both live by themselves. But we meet frequently. But this was great because, to me, theatre has always been the greatest joy. Right from my school days, the joys of family I was not familiar with. Until I met Ratna, and those have grown on me. So to combine the two is a definition of heaven.
Sure. You know, I was browsing through IMDb, the database, and it says your first acting role, your first film acting role was in Aman in 1967, and your character has been listed as standing behind the dead doctor.
Right. I was standing behind the dead doctor.
Can you describe that first?
Yeah, this was 1966. I was 16 years old. I had run away from home and come to Bombay to become an actor. Of course, I believed it would be only a matter of days before some big producer spotted me. And of course, it was a long story what happened to me there in the 2 months. But one of the things that I did in that 2 months, apart from applying unsuccessfully for jobs as a waiter, as a bellboy, as a shoe shine, etc., and being turned down for all, I worked as an extra on two movies. One was Hema Malini's first movie called Sapno Ka Saudagar, where I couldn't spot myself at all, despite trying very hard. And the other was this film called Aman, which starred Rajinder Kumar, who was the very big star those days. And a whole lot of other luminaries like Balraj Sahni and Chetan Anand and etc. And I was roped in unofficially as an extra, along with like 10 other pals of mine who used to hang around with that Pankosh. And we were paid 7 rupees 50 paisa a day, including lunch. And that was the first time I appeared in front of the camera. It was quite thrilling for me because I felt on the doorstep of, you know, my dreams coming true. And there was one really magical moment which I've also written about in my memoirs. We were standing in a line, and the camera was panning past us all one by one. And for some reason, when they were rehearsing it, the camera kind of stopped panning at a point where I could see my own reflection in it. And that was absolutely hypnotic. I cannot describe that moment. And then when they took the shot, I was staring straight into the camera and grinning, and I got shouted at for doing that. Supposed to be a funeral, you're not supposed to bloody smile. So I managed to not smile, but every time the camera went past, I managed to catch a look, glimpse of myself. That shot is not in the movie. The hero had it cut because I was so good in it. But there are a couple of shots. If you take the trouble to see this movie, and I wouldn't recommend it, right at the end, you'll see Rajendra Kumar Sahab being buried being taken off to be cremated. And as he's lying there, you'll see me right there. Because I managed to muscle my way right to the front, and I stood there. That was the first time I... another person who appeared in a Hindi film for the first time in that film was Lord Bertrand Russell. But we didn't have any scenes together. And that's a fact, I'm not joking. He was actually in that movie.
So as someone who completes 50 years of film acting, what motivates you as an actor in cinema, and what motivates you today as an actor in the theatre?
The fun of it. It starts with fun, as any young boy or girl who's acted on the stage and been applauded knows. And then, if you persevere, it ceases to be fun and enters into the realm of labor. And once you've conquered that phase of boredom and irritation at learning and having to, you know, master things, it becomes fun all over again. So it's really, really is enjoyable. Not only, and it's not the applause or anything that I'm talking about. It's the feeling of having got across. I've always had a problem with that. I was an introvert as a kid. I didn't have many friends. I was not comfortable in my own skin. I didn't like people. I was terrified of approaching strangers and so on. Some of that still remains with me, but most of it is gone. But to me, acting was a release, and being in theatre has provided me with not just great joy, but also with an education, because I think that all my reading, a lot of it started with reading plays, then I went on to reading other stuff. My understanding of people, my understanding of the world, my understanding of politics as it is, whatever, is all thanks to my association with the theatre. And when I have to do movies like Welcome Back and so on, the theatre provides a safety valve. Also, it gets you to engage with writing of a level which you cannot encounter in Hindi movies, you know. Difficult to find another Bernard Shaw in Hindi movies. Very difficult, if not impossible.
What's the trick to surviving a movie like Welcome Back?
You think of your bank balance.
You know, I've seen those films, and the truth is, you seem to be having a good time.
I'm having a good time, yeah, because I'm thinking of how much money I'm making. In other movies, I look like I'm having a good time because I'm getting my teeth into a wonderful script, or I'm working with a wonderful director, or something of that sort. But there have been other reasons to accept a movie. Artistic satisfaction is not the only kind of satisfaction in life.
So are you a grumpy artist on those sets?
If I'm asked to work late into the night, then I am. I hate night shootings. Absolutely the worst thing in the world. Only the one thing worse than night shooting is night shooting in the rain. So I'm grumpy when the occasion demands.
You know, in a recent interview, Mr. Sahab, you mentioned that you cannot have a conversation about acting with practically anyone from the film industry. Do you feel that way even about those...
I have been reflecting on that statement. Mm. And I regret having said it. It sounds terribly arrogant. I did not mean that. I think it was interpreted as such, who the hell do you think you are? Mm. You're the only one who can talk intelligently about acting? Mm. No, what I meant was that I met very few other actors who are interested in talking about acting.
Sure.
And it consumes me. I have very little else to talk about, really. I hate the sitting around and swapping anecdotes that happens on any issue, on any set, the gossip, the backbiting, you know. I would rather talk about the work. To me, the enjoyment of a shoot is engaging with the scenes, not sitting around and chatting between shots, you know. But Hindi commercial movies are one unending picnic. You're supposed to treat them as such, I guess.
And my next question is going to be, has your opinion of popular Hindi movies changed with time? With also the fact that now you're working with younger, newer filmmakers. You made a film like Waiting, which you enjoyed?
Yes, I did. I even enjoyed very much doing that one scene in Zoya's film.
Right.
I was very moved by that scene. There have been movies I've enjoyed, and there are others I haven't, but not necessarily that the ones which have been commercial have been hateful and the ones which have been artistic have been enjoyable, no.
Right.
Some of those have been misery as well.
Sure. What's your relationship like with the actors who, in a sense, cut their teeth in the parallel cinema movement with you in the 70s? Whether it's Shabana, whether it's Om Puri, whether it's Kulbhushan, Kharbanda. Do you still have a relationship with them?
Well, you see, Om and I have been friends much before we entered movies. We met in 1970 and we studied together in drama school and the Film Institute. We worked together in a zillion films. We worked together on the stage as well. He knows my family, I know his family. I mean, we're like brothers. And so there was no question of the relationship changing once we got into movies.
Right.
Shabana and Farooq and someone like Smita or Deepthi or other people who I worked with, I met them when I started working in movies. I have a very high regard for all these people as actors, but I think we move in different orbits, you know. Socially, I don't really meet these people much. Even Om I haven't met for a while now. To me, the working relationship is more precious than a friendship, you know. There's no animosity.
Sure.
But Shabana and I don't meet for years sometimes. If we're working together, it's like a new thing altogether. Yeah. We approach it without any biases. Yeah. We approach it without any expectations. And I think that's the best equation between two actors. A personal relationship intrudes, particularly in cinema. And that is the reason why scenes, romantic scenes of people, actors who are real life lovers,
right,
are so charming and believable. Because it's the real life that is getting over. Now that's not always required.
Sure.
You know? If the boy and girl hate each other and they have to do a romantic scene, you know, you'll be able to see through that.
Right.
It happens more in cinema than on the stage, and so it's perhaps best that Shabana and I, or Farooq or Smita and I, never became very close friends, despite having a very high regard for each other.
You know, you've often said, Naseer Saab, that popular Hindi cinema doesn't know what to do with you. Your wife, the very lovely, very talented Ratna Pathak, has now been sort of rediscovered in a sense, hasn't she? In popular cinema, we've seen her in things like Kapoor and Sons this year, Neel Bhatte Sannata, yeah. She was in Khoobsurat. Do you feel she's having better luck then?
Yeah, but I had my share of luck as well.
True.
I mean, despite not being suited to the part, I did a film called Three Dev, and which was a big hit.
Oi, Tirchi Topi Wale.
I
mean,
I don't think I've ever seen that film, you know. But it prolonged my career, and I'm grateful to it. I can't pretend I like it. But to go back to your very first statement, Rajiv, doesn't look labored. You should see some of my really bad movies. I've done quite a few. It looks labored as hell, particularly when I have to do a song, a romantic song. Yeah, what's a thing called Sunaina? You want to know what I mean?
You know, are there popular actors around the world, Naseer Saab, that you would like to or have liked to have had conversations about acting with? And I'm going back to that statement that you made.
You know, those people are stars of such a high luminosity that it is impossible to have any kind of a conversation with those people. I mean, I would have loved to talk to Marlon Brando, for example, but he despised acting, as he often said. So he would have probably, you know, told me to F.O. if I talked about acting to him. I'd love to talk with De Niro no more after hearing his interview in Goa. I've given up on that guy. But someone like Mr. Hoffman, or you know, someone like Humphrey Bogart, Spencer Tracy, these are actors I really loved. But a star of that caliber can only be friends with another star of that caliber. You can't have conversations with those people.
Everyone, I think I speak for everyone here, we all have our own favorite Nasiruddin Shah films. Masoom, throw names, Jaane Bhi Do Yaaron,
Karma.
Ijazat, Sparsh, Katha, Junoon, Albert Pinto Ka Gussa Kyun Aata Hai, Chamatkar, Mirch Masala, A Wednesday, Monsoon Wedding. Naseer Saab, if you were asked to program a retrospective of your work, what are the films you'd pick?
I would pick the ones which have been a little seen. See, my own favorite is Masoom, followed closely by Monsoon Wedding, and there are others too. Bhavni Bhavai, for example, a Gujarati film which very few people have seen. It's one of my finest works. It's a wonderful movie. The performances are a bit over the top, but it's an absolutely wonderful movie. Please try and see it if you can. I don't know even if there's a complete print available of it. Bhavni Bhavai, it's called. And there are others. But I would love to have a festival of my really bad movies.
You have a sense of humor about it, yeah?
Yeah. Zinda Jala Dunga. Followed by Mujhe Meri Biwi Se Bachao. Followed by Sunaina. Sona Spa. No, it'll end with Sona Spa. And so on. There's plenty of those. Pyara Dost is one. Which was the remake of Zorba the Greek, Yeah, with Amjad Khan and myself. It's available on YouTube.
Do you come across them on television surfing sometimes?
My sons come across them and wake me up at 2 in the morning to say, Baba, you gotta see this.
Soon they are going to make you the FTII director after seeing all of these films.
I'd never become the FTII director. It's a thankless job. I was on the governing council for 2 meetings until my suggestions proved too outrageous and they asked me to leave.
Much drama unfolded when you expressed your opinion about Rajesh Khanna earlier this year. That's not what I want to talk to you about. What I want to ask you about is Shammi Kapoor. I read in an interview that you were very, very fond of him and that you were put to tell us.
See, I think that when anybody watches a performance which you really feel bowled over by, the thing that makes you feel that is that I couldn't have done that. That's what I think. You don't analyze why this actor was so good, what was the depth in his book, etc., etc. You don't bother about all that. You just feel, hell, I couldn't have done that. And I feel that every time I see a truly great performance on stage or on cinema. When I saw Shombhu Mitra on the stage, when I saw Dr. Lagu on the stage, when I saw Neeru Phule on the stage, Bhakti Barve on the stage, when I've seen the early performances of Brando or De Niro, Dilip Kumar, Balraj Sahni in Kabuliwala and Do Bigha Zameen, films like that, truly great performances. I really felt, boy, you know, I couldn't have done that. That's the effect Shammi Kapoor had on me. That's the effect Dara Singh had on me. People are astonished when I say that my two favorite actors in Hindi cinema are Shammi Kapoor and Dara Singh. And I'm not joking when I say that. Because these are the two people whose films I always, always watched as a child. I would not go near a film called Sindoor, or Main Chup Rahungi, or Bahu Rani, or Sanj or Savera. I wouldn't go, I mean, wild horses couldn't drag me to see a movie like that, with a title like that. But I'd go and see Faulaad, with Dara Singh in it. Yeah. I'd go and see any Shammi Kapoor movie. And I knew they were not great movies. But then, which were the great movies in Hindi cinema? I couldn't appreciate Mughal-e-Azam when I was a child. I consider it one of the greatest movies ever made in India, but as a child I could not appreciate it. I could not appreciate Guru Dutt's movies at that time, or Bimal Roy's movies at that time. I loved these, you know, escapist movies. They were totally, you know, bina sar pair ke, as people say. Even to call them good, even to call them bad would be a compliment, you know. But I watched them all. And they gave me a lot. They gave me hours of pleasure. And something to aspire to. So when I was finally cast in the role of a muscle man, I remembered Dara Singh.
Have you seen
Shammi Kapoor, of course, I could never quite emulate. He was one of a kind.
Have you seen a Hindi film recently that made you go, I wish I was in this?
No, I don't think so. No. No.
Do you feel like the best parts for actors your age come to you?
Yes, I'm getting a lot of very interesting parts. I'm getting many more interesting parts than I got as a young man. I'm still being offered a lot of work, and it's great.
What Irfan Khan and Nawazuddin Siddiqui seem to have done is they've seemed to have found that sweet spot between commercial films and not embarrassing roles, if you like. Do you feel like it's because times have changed? Have they been luckier? Do you envy
I envy them. But I think they are both far more skillful actors than any of us were. More than I was, for sure. I think Nawaz and Irfan particularly are outstanding. It's still, however, Nawaz has succeeded in both kinds of movies, which is the first, really. And not just he's had a success, he's done damn well in those movies. It remains to be seen what the industry makes of actors like that. I'm very curious to see what Nawaz's future holds. I love him and I think he's great, but I'd be very interested to see, you know, what kind of parts the commercial film industry offers him. And the same with Irfan. Irfan may have international success waiting him, which would be just great.
That's something you pursued, but not hard enough?
I never pursued it. See, I knew that my being born in India is not a mistake of nature. My job is here. This is where I belong. When I was a kid, and after finishing college, and I thought I'd got to study acting, I thought of going to England. This was 1965 or something, but I didn't go because I couldn't afford to. You have to go there on your own expense to audition and so on. And I'm glad I didn't, because if I had, I'd probably ended up like Saeed Jafri or Zia Mohideen, you know, who did work for many years, but never quite got the recognition they deserved. And so, you know, my dreams, see, I aspired to the quality of work that I saw actors like Spencer Tracy and Paul Muni and others of that doing. Not to do the kind of acting that I saw in Indian movies. Which is why I've never found Indian movies fascinating as much as I found those movies. Then, of course, when I discovered the French and Japanese and German and so on, the whole new world opened up for me. But when I started, it was just these, you know, India. There was nothing more than that. But I forgot your question.
That you didn't pursue.
I didn't. So I dreamt of playing the cowboy and playing the old man in the sea and etc. and farewell to arms and everything. But I never actively pursued it because I knew that my job is here. And luckily, I was right because when I appeared on the scene in 1975, I was very lucky that actors like me were needed. They needed people, actors who could look real. Like real people, not like, you know, matinee idols. And so I got a lot of work. I was just lucky accident. I was in the right place at the right time. And I appreciated that. I would have liked to work in Hollywood, and that curiosity was satisfied by doing The League of Extraordinary Gentlemen. And I realized there's not all that much difference between Hollywood and the B word, which I hate. There's no difference at all, in fact, except they have more money and better taste. Otherwise, it's the same story over there and over here. And I was very curious to see how they do these monstrous $100 million movies, and I saw that. It's as boring as anything, you know. And I could hardly sit through the movie when I saw it. Then I worked in England on the stage. I worked in Paris on the stage. So all those dreams have kind of been sublimated.
Sure. You came so close, famously, to landing the lead in Gandhi, and then it, as you often said, Ben Kingsley turned up and you saw that there was no chance. Do you sometimes wonder about where the career would have gone had you done that?
No, but what I do wonder about is, if I had got the role, what would have become of Ben Kingsley? Nothing would have happened to my career if I had done that part. Even if I had won an Oscar, I would have come right back to Bombay and acted in Akbar Khan's Hadsa. Absolutely nothing would have happened. Ben Kingsley, look, but nothing happened to Rohini. Her performance was equally good. How come she never got any work abroad? Because I leave the rest to your imagination.
You know, you famously speak, you say it as it is. Does that make you very popular?
Among Rajesh Khanna's followers, no.
You have a lot of friends, let me put it this way. Do you have a lot of friends in the film industry?
No, not one. Well, I don't get work in the film industry because I have friends. Yes, I do. I have friends. I have Jackie and Danny and Tinu Anand and Satish Shah. But Satish is really television. Right. And it's through Ratna that I, you know, became close to it. But these three are my pals. They are the only three from the film industry who ever come over to my home or whose homes I've been to. Apart from these three, no one. I don't find the company of film industry people very stimulating.
I speak to young actors all the time and they're always talking about how great it is to work with Naseer Saab, whether it's Shahid Kapoor who has worked with you, whether it's other actors who trained under you. You know, they're always speaking in platitudes. Do you find that they know your work? Or do you think it's just sort of, you know, token?
Yeah, it sounds like an intelligent thing to say. I really doubt whether they've seen much of my work.
As someone who's worked in Pakistani films, Naseer Saab in Khuda Ke Liye and Zinda Bhag certainly, what did you make of the political uproar over Indian producers casting Pakistani actors recently and what they put?
I thought it was absolutely uncalled for, unnecessary. And the sad part is that if you say this, your patriotism is immediately questioned. The fact is there was another young Pakistani actor in that film, which nobody knows about. The fuss was made only over the guy who was well known. And it was craven, I would think, of Karan Johar to submit like that. It was craven. When the government had offered him full support, I think it was absolutely craven. And this was, I mean, and I'm so glad the army has refused this extortion money.
How should the creative arts be viewed in this sort of instance?
They should not be confused with politics. I mean, our animosity and our hatred is not for the people of Pakistan. It's for their policies, it's for their government, it's for their damn army. It's for the fact that our soldiers get killed. We don't hate the people of Pakistan, and the people of Pakistan don't hate the people of India either. So what is worrisome is this kind of sentiment being drummed up all over the country. It does no one any good, in my opinion.
What was your own experience working in Pakistan?
Absolutely wonderful. But you say that and you're an anti-national. Someone says Pakistan is not hell, anti-national. It is absolutely dreadful.
Would you have to think about it before you said yes if there was another offer?
Obviously. But the fact is that we have not broken off diplomatic ties with Pakistan. We are not at war with them. Otherwise, close down the embassy. Close down every other business. No, nothing has happened. We still have diplomatic relations with them, but artists will be beaten up if they stay here. It's very easy to beat up defenseless artists, yeah? You're so brave, go and beat up the infiltrators. Go and burn up cinema halls, go and burn down enemy camps.
Does it scare you where we're heading?
I'm determined to look at the positive side. Somebody earlier in a press conference asked me what I feel about the present government and so on. I did refrain from making any comment, but I have to admit that I had a great sense of hope. I still do, and I refuse to lose it.
Have we become too touchy, too easily offended as a nation?
Yeah. I mean, look at the Rajiv Gandhi case, for example. I said the same thing about him several times earlier, but I mean the excrement hit the air conditioner very hard this time, and I can't for the life of me understand why. I can fully understand why his family got upset. It hurt their feelings. I apologized to them while making it clear that I was not withdrawing what I said.
Mm.
I stand by what I said. It's my opinion, you're free to agree or disagree with it. But if you disagree, then offer a cogent rebuttal, yeah? Don't start giving me this nonsense about respect for the dead. What respect did the industry have for Rajesh Khanna when he was alive? And no longer a money-making machine. What respect did they have for him? So I can fully understand, I don't give a hoot about his fans. But I really deeply care for the feelings of his family, because Dimple and Twinkle are both people I have a regard for. So I made it a point to apologize. But I do not withdraw what I said. And it's really funny how a lot of uninvolved people have gotten more aggravated than Dimple even. You know? Calling me a frustrated, bitter failure. Another one says, oh, that fellow criticizes everybody. He even criticizes Dilip Kumar and Amitabh Bachchan. So are Dilip Kumar and Amitabh Bachchan beyond criticism? Mr. Bachchan doesn't mind being criticized. So who are you to mind?
How do you view the functioning of the CBFC, particularly under the chairmanship of Pellar and Lamy?
The man with the axe. They forget that they are a board of film certification. They are not a moral police. I think they need to be reminded that CBFC stands for Central Board of Film Certification, not Central Board of Film Censorship. I think it's pretty ridiculous, their approach.
Are we regressing? James Bond can't kiss. You can't say Punjab in Uttar Punjab. You can't name cities.
Yeah. Jungle Book is too frightening.
Culture towards canting down, just...
It does seem like that.
Are you disappointed?
Well, there's still another 2 years to go.
You know, why do you feel, and I think I speak here for a lot of people, I think I speak for a lot of people across the country, why do you feel that artists particularly, and do not speak up?
Because they get hounded so easily. You see, you know, all this, this misconception that stars have when thousands of people are going ape outside their houses, that these people love me. Boy, they do not love you. They resent you. They would tear you to bits if they could. The way they thump your car, the way they thump you on the back, the way they'll jostle and, you know, misbehave with a woman if she's alone. This is not love. It's a pure delusion. And someday you're going to have to confront it, you know. It's and so, if an actor makes what we consider a misstep, everybody delights in climbing onto him and giving him what they feel he deserves. When any of these boys made a statement which, you know, which perhaps they should not have made, but I don't think there was anything wrong with what they said. And yet look at the storm that erupted. The same people who will happily go and buy tickets for their next movie were suddenly outraged. Because it's great fun to tear these guys down.
Ideally, do you think it's important that artists have a voice? Because it carries weight.
I think that an actor's beliefs are expressed through the kind of work he opts to do. An actor's job is dependent on many other inputs.
Then that's scary, no?
Yeah, so then don't do the work that you don't agree with. If there's a film which is regressive in its approach, don't do it. No matter how good the payday may be.
In your memoir, Naseer Saab, you discuss in beautiful detail the shooting of your first Shyam Benegal film, Nishan. I'm quoting you. You said, "What affected me the most was the trust he reposed in the actors, the assurance in dealing with them, and his compassion for every character." You mentioned how you felt like a spoiled child because the assistants used to come and tell you that you're becoming one of his favorites. Have you imbibed those qualities as a director?
Well, as a film director, I was a big failure, except where dealing with my actors was concerned. I think in every other way I failed in that movie. The actors I was lucky enough to have were absolutely the best actors I could think of, and they were tremendously supportive, and I'd do anything for any of them at any time. But I think I failed in every other department.
You know, I know you've said that, we've spoken about that. Do you believe that because you're unhappy with the film or with how it did? Because
no.
I don't know. I mean,
I didn't expect it to do well.
Sure.
In fact, I'm surprised that a guy like Shabir opted to produce it. I didn't expect it to do well. I hoped to make a better movie. I didn't. So anyway, that's another story. But I tried handling the actors the way Shyam did in Nishant, the way I remember him doing in Nishant and in Manthan. With great love, you know, to be able to understand an actor's strengths and weaknesses, and cover the weaknesses and enhance his strengths. Because on film, you are totally dependent on your director. Which is why I'm not being modest when, you know, when I'm praised for Mirza Ghalib or any of those other works. I give more than 50% of the credit to the writer and the director. Because there are umpteen instances of great actors failing in poorly written films.
But was that film directing experience so scarring that you would not return?
Yeah. Yeah.
And you speak for the future as well?
I think so. Unless I can summon up the energy. Everything's gone off?
Is it that
energy? But you can still hear, right?
Oh, yes.
Yes. Yes.
Except I can summon up the energy to approach it again and be a little better prepared technically, which I doubt is going to happen. Because I have much more fun directing on the stage. You know, in movies, once you've done it, it's done. 100 years later, people will still see the movie and say, ha ha. Right? So that's really scary. You got to make the right decision quickly. And I find myself incapable of doing that. I need to stew. I need to think about it. I need to look at it, revise it, improve it, which one can do on the stage. Even after 100 performances of a play, we still make amendments, we still make changes, we still improve things, and so on. So, directing on the stage is much more fun. Secondly, you're not dealing with so much money, you know, that is such a burden.
The stakes are higher.
Yeah, man. Somebody else's money. Ooh. If it's your own money, then you don't need to worry.
Have you seen a Hindi film recently that you really enjoyed? Or a few?
Oh, sure. Kapoor and Sons was wonderful, I thought. Mm. Masaan was a fantastic movie. I saw some Marathi movies recently were fantastic. I saw Highway, which was superb, which is showing right now, in fact. You people have all missed it. Then I saw Umesh's other film, the one about the temple, Deur.
Deur,
yeah, again, absolutely superb. Then I saw Nat Samrat,
right.
Which was also very, very good. And there's some tremendous work being done in Marathi. Not so much in Hindi, but still there is a bit. Thing like Dam Laga Ke Aisa was
true.
A superb movie.
Mm.
And there have been some others. But not too many. I find it difficult, in fact, now to recall.
Do you find, as you get older, Nasir Saab, do you find yourself thinking about your legacy?
No. Why should I think about it? I won't be there. No, I don't bother about it. I've done what I could possibly have done, and I intend to continue that way for the rest of my life. But I don't worry about how I'm going to be remembered and all that. That's up to the... It's not my problem. Yeah.
I think we have time for a few questions.
Good evening, first of all, sir. You know, you spoke about a lot of problems, both of you, that we are facing today with in terms of model policing and a lot of other things happening, right? And I heard you before talking to the press, and you said you're a bit of a rebellious person. So, what can we do as filmmakers today, or what would you have done if you could just tell us, well, how can we make a change or impact this in any way? Considering you also said that audience is used to trash, and that's how it's going to be, and
yeah,
it's going to take another 100 years. So, what can you do?
I would say, first of all, as audiences,
As audiences, you got to start rejecting the crap. First, you got to start identifying it and rejecting it. Mr. Ray wrote this in his book 50 years ago, Our Films, Their Films, that he says, I wish the audiences were more demanding. It was only 50 years then, now it's 100 years. Now it's really difficult. So, to start with, all you can do is to not only watch movies as a time pass. That's most important, and I'm addressing this to every youngster or even every person of my age who's here. Stop watching movies as a time pass, start studying them and start discriminating. As a filmmaker, be aware that, you know, bringing about a change is a very nebulous and wide ambition to have. One should not have this kind of change the world kind of thing. Consider it your duty as a filmmaker to make movies which are truthful reflection of their times. Because as I said, movies will be seen 100 years later also. And if 100 years later they find Welcome Back to tell them what the India of 2016 was like, you know, that would be a big tragedy. They should find a movie which is truthful to its times. Movies are the only art form which can do that, to record life as it is. Every other art form has to resort to abstraction sooner or later. Writing, music, painting, poetry, everything. Film is a conglomeration of all these forms. It's a mixture of painting and sculpture and architecture and photography and painting and music and everything. It combines all these elements, and thus it can capture life as it is. As a filmmaker, I would think that's your responsibility. Don't think in wide, impossible to achieve terms of changing things. The change won't happen in your lifetime, but you'll have done your bit.
Do we have other questions?
Yeah, this side.
Yeah.
Hello, sir.
Hello.
So we have seen that you have shown your interest in short content in last years. So do you really think that small content is more powerful and easily accessible to the audiences in the social media world?
I think firstly it is much more difficult to make a short film than to make a feature length film. It is in the same way as it is very more difficult to write a short story than it is to write a full-length one. Because you have to put in everything into 10 minutes. It's not an easy job, particularly as a filmmaker. And I really think that short films are the way to go, because it's a fact that everyone's attention span is reducing. No one has the patience to sit through a 3-hour film any longer at one stretch. Things have to become smaller, in the same way as theatre too has to become smaller if we want to get across to the maximum number of people. It's impossible for us, at least for me, to dream of doing spectacular productions which will be attended by thousands of people. I'd much rather perform to 20 people and make sure that I get across to all 20, and that is the future of cinema and of theatre. Things will get smaller and smaller. As you know, it's already happened. The single screen theatres are gone. In Mumbai, I think there's 2 left. Rest of them all become multiplexes, where they screen small movies which seat 100 people or 150 people. It will sooner or later become, the audiences will shrink even more. And we as theatre people also have to live with that. That the audiences will shrink even more, but we have to search out our audiences and make sure we get through to them. So I really think that short films are a very, very important form. And I think documentaries are equally important. Because I think if any kind of cinema has the power to change people, to make them rethink their values, it's documentaries, not feature films.
I just want to jump in from where he asked. We saw Adhiraj's film today. It's a charming little film. And you're wonderful in it. Adhiraj, I know, was an assistant to Vishal Bhardwaj. He perhaps had access. Do you find a lot of youngsters with short film scripts pitching you web series?
Yeah.
And are you accessible for that? I'm asking for the.
Yes, I am. I've read about 20 short film scripts since Adhiraj's, because they all thought that since I've done that, I'm willing to do anything. He must be sitting at home doing nothing. So okay, I'll do this. But none of those matched up to Adhiraj's script, and so I didn't do any of them. But I am really open to it, and I would really like to do more.
Sure. Do we have time for a few more questions? Does anyone have a question?
I have yes. a question. So I would like to ask you, do you see any hopes for Indian television? Because we have been for the past 1.5 years looking at Pakistani TV series on Zindagi channel, and they are wonderful.
Yeah, they're amazing.
Pakistan got television much before India did.
Yes.
They started making television work
much earlier than us. Also, note that television in the West started or became really widespread sometime in the 1950s. It's only now that really great work is emerging from television. All these serials like House of Cards and so on, which are absolutely brilliant. It looks like the best writers in America and England have gone into television. And they've left the making of the superhero movies to the hacks, and that's the only kind of movie that's being made. But on television, there's really interesting work being done. So maybe that'll happen in India at some point. Also, at that time, when Pakistani television, the old serial also used to be very good. There was hardly any Pakistan film industry. And also, the Pakistan film industry has more or less collapsed over the last 4 or 5 years. The Punjabi blood-soaked revenge dramas that they used to make have stopped, thank heavens. And they've started making television work instead. So more and more people are into television. At the moment, I don't see much hope, because it's all about money right now. When it ceases to be so much about money, then maybe we can hope for some change or improvement.
Yeah, gentlemen.
Hello, sir. Sir, how is voice modulation important for an actor? Like, do you think the theatre actors have more, like, good voice modulation than television actors?
How is voice modulation important? Because when you act, you may be asked to modulate your voice. Then how do you do it?
So that's...
Or are you're asking what?
Exactly? Sir, I'm asking, like, how to, like, modulate your voice.
How do... Yeah, it's taken me about 50 years to learn it. And I have to confess that after studying acting at the drama school for 3 years and at the Film Institute for 2 years, and being directed by many renowned people, no one could teach me anything about voice until I met a voice and speech therapist who watched me on stage, and I was performing with a voice like this because my voice had gone. And he gave me the remedy to my problem. It's too long to explain to you, but it's all to do with breathing. Are you a singer or a dancer or anything like that?
I'm studying acting.
You're studying acting. Yeah, well, learn about breathing on your own, because nobody's going to teach you anything about it. All they say is, you must be heard in the last row. Yeah? So if you concentrate only on being heard in the last row, what about the guy in the first row? He's going to go deaf. You have to make sure that the same level of voice reaches everybody. It's a technique which, if you are very keen to learn, you will learn. The only thing I can suggest to you is get a harmonium and practice the sargam. And if you know anyone who is a classical singer, just meet that person and ask them about diaphragm breathing. That's what you need to learn. And all the voice modulation and the progress will be very slow, let me warn you, and very boring, but you won't realize when it's happened.
The gentleman at the back, yeah.
Hello, sir. Sir, Mirza Ghalib ke role ke bare mein aapse baat karna chahunga. It was a dream role for you. Maine aapke ek interview mein dekha jisme aapne kaha ki meri tamanna thi ki Mirza Ghalib sahib ka main role karu. तो सर मुझे पूछना था कि ऐसा क्या आपने मिर्ज़ा गालिब सर के बारे में स्टडी किया, या ऐसी कौन सी चीज़ें थी जिन्होंने आपको इतना अट्रैक्ट कर दिया कि आप उनके रोल को करने के लिए तैयार थे? और जैसा कि हम सबको पता है, गुलजार जी ने वो मूवी बनाई थी, इट वॉज अ सीरीज, तो उसके लिए पहले संजीव कुमार जी को मेरे ख्याल से किया गया था अप्रोच, लेकिन अनफॉर्चुनेटली उनकी हेल्थ इश्यूज की वजह से वो रोल कर नहीं पाए थे. तो सर, व्हाट वाज योर रिएक्शन व्हेन यू गॉट अ कॉल फ्रॉम गुलजार कि मिर्ज़ा साहिब, मिर्ज़ा गालिब के लिए आपको सिलेक्ट किया गया?
मैंने फौरन उनसे कहा कि हाँ, मैं करूँगा. मुझे सोचने की एक मिनट, एक सेकंड भी. देखिए, मैं अंग्रेजी स्कूल में पढ़ा बचपन में, नैनीताल में, और उर्दू बोलना मैंने सबसे पहले सीखा, क्योंकि घर पर उर्दू बोली जाती थी. जब ने बोलना सीखा तो जाहिर है उर्दू ही सबसे पहले सीखी. सो सबसे पहली जबान जो मेरे कान में पड़ी वो उर्दू थी. फिर हम सब उर्दू बोलना सीख गए अंग्रेजी स्कूल में. लेकिन जब हम घर आते थे छुट्टियों में, तो नैनीताल से दिल्ली आते थे हम लोग, और दिल्ली पे उतर के मेरे एक चचा थे जो गली कासिम जान में रहते थे, बल्ली मारान में, उनके यहाँ हम जाते थे खाना वाना खाने के लिए. तो हमेशा वहाँ जाते हुए हमें बताया जाता था कि ये मिर्ज़ा गालिब का घर है, जो उस वक्त टूटा फूटा पड़ा था, कोयले की टाल थी वहाँ.
अब रेनोवेट हो गया थोड़ा सा,
अब रेनोवेट हुआ है, जो ऐवान गालिब वगैरह, पर उस जमाने में. और मैं सोचता था कि ये इतने बड़े अगर ये शायर थे, तो इनका घर की, उनकी घर की ये हालत कैसे है? दैट्स ऑल आई न्यू अबाउट हिम. उनके बारे में कुछ नहीं मालूम था, सिर्फ ये कि वो शराब बहुत पीते. और स्कूल में उनका एक शेर जो था, बड़ा मशहूर था, जो मैं सभ्य सोसाइटी में नहीं दोहरा सकता. बाद में पता चला कि वो उनका लिखा हुआ था ही नहीं. और एक उनका शेर जो मेरे एक दोस्त ने मुझे पढ़ के सुनाया कि कोई दिन घर जिंदगानी और है, हमने अपने जी में ठानी और है, दे के खत मुंह देखता है नाम भर, कुछ तो पैगामे जबानी और है. तो मुझे अपनी गर्लफ्रेंड के खत का इंतजार रहता था, तो ये शेर बड़ा अच्छा लगा. इसके अलावा मुझे मिर्ज़ा गालिब के बारे में कुछ भी नहीं मालूम था, अलावा ये कि बड़ी लंबी सी टोपी पहनते थे. फिर धीरे धीरे उनके कुछ अशार से मेरी वाकफियत हुई, और याद आने लगी ये बातें मुझे कि उनका घर वगैरह ये वो. और फिर बातें होने लगीं कि गालिब पर फिल्म बनेगी. मैं जब स्टूडेंट था फिल्म इंस्टीट्यूट में, तो ये रोल, एक मेन रोल करने की लालच थी. सच बताऊं तो गालिब के बारे में मुझे खाक मालूम नहीं था, और इत्तेफाक से वो मिल गया मुझे, और मेरी जिंदगी की सबसे बड़ी खुशकिस्मती थी कि वो मुझे मिला. हालांकि फिर मैं जोर दे के कहूँगा, मुझे बड़ी खुशी होती है जब मेरी तारीफ होती है, और मुझे जो दुआएं मिलती हैं उसकी वजह से, मैं बहुत एहसान मंद हूँ इसका, लेकिन उसकी पूरी जिम्मेदारी मेरी नहीं है, उसका सेहरा मेरे सर पे नहीं गुलजार भाई के सर पे है कि उन्होंने जिस तरह से उसको लिखा और जिस तरह से उनको उसने पेश किया और जगजीत भाई ने जिस तरह से उसके म्यूजिक का कंपोजिशन किया और जिस तरह से उन्होंने गाया। खुशकिस्मती थी मेरी कि जगजीत भाई थे वहाँ पे, कि मेरी आवाज़ उनसे इस कदर मेल खाती थी कि और क्योंकि उनके कुछ गज़लों में मैंने बीच में बोला है तो लोग एक्चुअली कभी कुछ को लोग समझते हैं कि मैंने ही गाए हैं वो, तो मैं फौरन इनकार कर देता हूँ कि नहीं ये बिल्कुल मैंने नहीं, ये जगजीत भाई ने गाई है। तो बस
और नसीर भाई ये वाला आप इस तरह की बात आपने एक मैंने यूट्यूब में वीडियो देखा था जिसमें आम गुलजार और गालिब की आप बात कर रहे हैं, बहुत ही कमाल का है। तो उसमें आई वॉज फैसिनेटेड बाई हाउ यू गिव इम्पोर्टेंस टू द स्क्रिप्ट एंड दैट बिकम्स द फिलोसफी ऑफ लाइफ। यू से दैट गुलजार साहब से आपने एक चीज़ सीखी थी जिसमें वो कहते हैं कि अगर तुमको कुछ चाहिए होगा तो वो स्क्रिप्ट में होगा और अगर नहीं चाहिए होगा तो नहीं होगा। बस तो मतलब दिस वॉज सो फैसिनेटिंग, आई वॉज लाइक वंडरफुल एंड इट्स अमेजिंग यू नो व्हेन यू गेट टू हियर यू लाइव राइट नाउ और गुलजार साहब और थ्रू योर क्रिएशन।
बिकॉज लोग मुझसे पूछते हैं कि आपने बड़ा रिसर्च किया होगा, मैं कुछ नहीं किया भाई, मैंने उनके कुछ खतूत पढ़े, कुछ उनकी शायरी पढ़ी और इमोशनली उनसे अपने आप को जोड़ने की कोशिश की। भाई किसी रोल को करने के लिए उसको साइको एनालाइज करना जरूरी नहीं है। मैं गालिब साहब को क्या समझूंगा, मैं समझने चला हूं गालिब को या बर्नार्ड शॉ को या आइंस्टाइन को, मुझे 7 जन्म लग जाएंगे उनको समझने में। तो उनको समझना जरूरी नहीं है, उनके साथ एम्पथाइज करना जरूरी है, उनके जज्बात समझने जरूरी हैं और उन जज्बात को जितनी डिग्निटी के साथ पेश किया जा सके। क्योंकि गुलजार भाई से मेरी शुरू में बात हुई, मैंने कहा कि गुलजार भाई ये हर वक्त शराब पीते थे, तो हाँ तो मैंने कहा ही वॉज एन अल्कोहलिक, नहीं ये लफ्ज इस्तेमाल मत करो क्योंकि अल्कोहलिक इमीडिएटली इवोक समथिंग एल्स। तो इफ यू वॉन्ट टू प्ले हिम लाइक फॉलिंग ऑल ओवर द प्लेस तो ये मैं नहीं करने दूंगा। तो क्योंकि किसी भी किरदार की पूरी जिंदगी नहीं दिखाई जाती, उसकी जिंदगी के कुछ सिलेक्टेड हिस्से दिखाए जाते हैं, तो वो मैं नहीं दिखाना चाहता। जरूर होंगे नशे में गालिब साहब, गिर भी पड़ते होंगे, उल्टियां भी करते होंगे, पर वो सब दिखाना जरूरी नहीं है। So what he said was absolutely right, ki what you need to know is in the script. Or it was really true.
And that is the script of your life. I related it that way, that you know, that's your destiny or whatever you call it. That's why the problem is why we are so restless and dukhi ki hum bhagte rehte hain un cheezon ke liye jo aapki script mein nahi hai.
Exactly. Actors hamesha ye तड़पते रहते हैं ये जानने के लिए कि इस कैरेक्टर को महसूस क्या हो रहा है, व्हाट इज दिस कैरेक्टर फील। इट इज नॉट सो इम्पोर्टेंट एज टू अंडरस्टैंड व्हाट इज दिस कैरेक्टर डूइंग। द वर्ड एक्ट मींस, डज एनीबॉडी हियर नो,
कैन नॉट डू एनीथिंग,
नो, व्हाट इज द वर्ड एक्ट मीन इन द डिक्शनरी। आई हैव नॉट येट टिल टुडे मेट अ सिंगल एक्टर who has checked up the meaning of the word act in the dictionary.
To do something that somebody else
to do.
To do.
They say to play different characters, to do other, you know, to perform, to speak dialogue. No, it means to do. To perform means the same thing. To do. So it's more important for you as an actor to figure out what is this character doing at this time. Because no character ever appears on stage or in a film for no reason at all. He appears for a reason. He appears with an intention. It's important to figure out that the emotion will follow, not the other way around. But actors are dying to emote, you see. They feel there's nothing more to acting but laughing and crying. Crying. If you can cry, you are a great actor. You know? And the better you cry, the more better you are. In our country particularly, crying is mistaken for good acting. And believe me, crying is the easiest thing that an actor is ever called upon to do. Yes.
I'm a Tibetan. Actually, theater is like a just newborn baby in our society. And I'm trying my best to start this in our community. And since 2011, I tried a lot. And I went to the Mumbai to watch some change in Tibetan theater. And I found out, like, theater is becoming more like luxurious, like, kind of thing. Today's life, and people over there are all like talking about the fame, all about the money, all this. They doesn't have much, I didn't see much passion of acting. And then I thought, like, such kind of theater is a little bit difficult to start in society, like our society.
Yes, yes, absolutely.
Our society is not much developed, and so we are just like so that's why I'm very happy to be here and ask you the how to start a good theater in society like us.
Okay.
And can you please
Yes, I have an answer for you.
Thank you.
And I completely agree with you about the quality of the majority of the theatre in Bombay. It is very commercial. And now the corporates have entered, so the budgets have gone into many, many lakhs for a play, not for a film. Huh? And we are all in Bombay and in Delhi as well, maybe in Calcutta and Bangalore too, aspiring to the kind of theatre that happens on Broadway, which is the kind of theatre where you don't know if you're seeing a play or a film. That is, to my mind, not theatre at all. The kind of stuff that happens on Broadway, where you have, like in a film, a scenery of a drawing room disappears within seconds and replaced by a scenery of a forest. The forest disappears, replaced by a hut. The hut disappears, replaced by... I've actually seen a play where the Titanic goes across the stage. You know? This is not theater. To me, this is part magic show, part rock concert, part cabaret. You know? It's not theater. If you just think back, I'll subject you all to a little bit of a lecture about it, since he's asked this very pertinent question, which I think is important. How did theatre begin? This was told to us in our drama school. It did not begin with a view to entertain. It did not begin with a view to make money or to become famous or anything. It began with a view to communicating the same idea to everyone present. And this happened, this is an assumption, but it makes great sense to me. In the days of the caveman, when there was no language, they used to communicate in sounds. There was no clothes, there were no homes. They lived in the wide open. They had two needs in their lives. One was food and one was shelter and clothing. And both these needs were provided for by hunting. They had to go on a hunt. Before going on the hunt, they had to rehearse the hunt. They would have to practice the hunt. They had to make sure that everybody gets the same idea. So they would enact the hunt. Now, there's no proof of this anthropologically, but it makes complete sense to me. So one person would become the deer. The hunters would plan, how do we get the deer? The deer had to think of ways to escape. One person became a tiger, one person became this, one person became a cloud, one became the rain, one became a rock, etc., etc. That's how theatre began. Not to entertain, not to make money, but to communicate the same idea to everyone present. Now, gradually, there must have been some guy who played the deer better than anyone else. So he was always cast as the deer. Then he started saying, but I want 10 rocks instead of 5 to play the deer. And I want to do this scene in this way. So the star system began, right? And the various actors, somebody played the lion very well, somebody played the bhalu very well, somebody played the snake. You know, so typecasting began, way back with the caveman, right? So if you go back to this form of theatre, what you realise is that what you need is one person to convey the idea and one person to receive it. You should attempt theatre of that kind. Find a play or find a story which you can stand up on the stage and tell to 20 people. with the deep desire to get across to them. That is where I think you will find your direction in theatre, because I truly, truly believe that we are always on the stage. In the cities, we load the stage with too many unnecessary things which are there only for decoration, and they are only for to satisfy the audience. They are not necessary at all. The only things necessary are an actor and the words and one receptive member of the audience. That's all you need to do theatre.
So welcome to Dharamshala. We're very glad that you're here amidst us today. My name is Megha and I work as a principal here in one of the local schools. For a very long time, I as an educationist have been feeling the dire necessity of some kind of a film which addresses the issue of sex education. Because that's what I deal with every day. We have youngsters who don't really know what's happening to them. They're getting a little digressed, they're getting a little disturbed. We do try and probably counsel them. But ours is a society wherein no matter how open you want to be with your children, especially teachers and students, there is a barrier wherein they don't want to go beyond, you know, in terms of conversation. Now, recently we had a movie called Pink, which addressed the required issue in a beautiful manner. Can we hope of something like that coming up for the younger generation, 10-year-olds, 12-year-olds, 14-year-olds? Because that is the age group wherein they don't really know what's happening to them, but a lot is happening to them.
Yeah.
And we find it very difficult to communicate through words.
I don't think you could hope for that from the film industry.
Nothing.
No, absolutely nothing.
Because you know when
Pink was also only made more out of concern of making many bucks, not really to addressing the cause. The fact that it addressed the cause was, I think, a secondary.
Was it a byproduct?
Byproduct, yeah. But I really don't have the answer. But my wife, Ratna, I don't know if she's here.
We saw her on the way.
Right. She works in an NGO called Abacus Avehi, which is dedicated to audio-visual enhancement awareness of children in municipal schools. And sex education is one of the things that they deal with. So I really think what she would have to say to you, at some point, I guess you would get together with her and talk to her about it. I think she'd have more something more informative to say than I would.
Good evening, Nasir. I'm Colonel, commanding a unit here of the Army. And for all of everybody's interest, you know, I would like to know, when is Ishqiya 2 coming? We're waiting for it.
It's come and gone.
It's come and gone. Yeah, Ishqiya 3, sorry. 3.
No, 3. There's no 3 because Dear Ishqiya was a failure. So, yeah, it was a lovely movie, but it flopped at the box office. So there's no reason to make a third one.
Everybody in the unit asked me that you must ask him the question when Ishqiya 3 is coming. You know, waiting for a single breath. Yeah. Thank you.
Oh, well, good evening, sir. My question is, what's your definition of cinema?
I think I made that definition. I spoke to that filmmaker there.
I just need to know your perspective.
To me, a definition of a good film is one which fulfills its intentions. All right? It's futile to accuse a David Dhawan film of not having a social conscience. Right? It's not pretending to have one. Its purpose is to make you laugh for 2.5 hours until you fall off your seat. It succeeds in that intention, so I guess it could be called a good movie, you know. So to me, a good film is that which succeeds in its intention. If the intention is to disturb you, you know, if you make a film like Masaan, I don't know how many of you have seen that, truly disturbing film, makes you feel bad. If you've seen a film like Aankhon Dekhi, made by Rajat Kapoor,
we showed both of them here at DIFF.
There you go.
Yeah.
So, more strength to DIFF and show more such movies here. And,
Before we end, what's been your, I mean, I know you've only been here a day, but what's been your experience? What kind of, you know, what made you go, I want to come here to DIFF?
Well, curiosity about Dharamshala, first of all. And the fact that I'm very proud of this film, Interior Cafe Night. And I wanted to be here for its screening. and I wanted to, you know, because I had a very stressful 2 weeks in Bombay preparing that place, so I wanted to get the hell out of that city. And I must say, I'm so glad I came, because it's I'm feeling completely unwound. And I have to say, I'm not a great fan of film festivals. I seldom go to them. I find them frenetic and too busy, and there's too much hot air all around. This is truly the first film festival I've ever been to, which I've enjoyed, and which I feel. And which I truly felt was a celebration of cinema rather than a marketplace where you're trying to hustle, you know.
Ritu, well done.
Yeah, well done, Ritu. And Tenzin. And all of you who organized this.
All of you. One more
all person. The volunteers, everyone.
So there's one lady there, one and we'll have to. Yeah.
Sir, actually, Jaane Bhi To Yaar is one of my favorite movies ever, and I think most people would agree with that. But I've always been concerned about the ending of the movie. I wonder, is it left to interpretation, or did you have a say in it? What was your opinion about the ending? Because
I loved it. I the only suggestion I made was that this gesture of our throats being cut, but it was Kundan's idea, and he wanted that end. And I think it's a very appropriate end. And I mean, it was not a film about heroes. It was not a film about guys who are setting society right or people who have a sense of mission or anything. These are two idiots who, you know, who stumble upon something which they can't handle. And misguidedly try to set it right, and of course they can't. I mean, look at the level of corruption that there was when Jaane Bhi To Yaar was made, and look at the level of corruption today. Kundan tried making a sequel, but I mean the level of corruption we're dealing with today is unimaginable. And where do you start? And secondly, at that time, losing an attorney to a policeman was a big thing for any of us. We were all struggling actors, we were all homeless. I was the only guy with a home and a car, and no one else, everyone else, we were all sitting on the road between shots. We were sharing our food and so on. There were no air-conditioned vans for any of us. There was no makeup rooms, nothing. We shot the entire film on location. And even to Kundan, losing an attorney to a policeman is no longer as important as it was then. Now you'd have to jip him of 50 lakhs, you know, to shake him out of his stupor, not 50 paisa. And we've all changed. You know, we're all more prosperous than we were. Even the guy who played the policeman, who takes away that attorney, you know, has became a famous actor. And when he tried to make the sequel, I said, look, it'll only work if you get all of us together again, and I don't think you will. I said, try getting all of us together for a party, and you won't be able to. So he did write a script. It didn't quite work out. Then, of course, Ravi passed away, so that ended the matter.
Good evening, sir.
Good evening.
I wanted to know what attracted you to Adi Raj's script. I've been really curious about it. Interior Cafe Night. Was there one particular thing that attracted you?
Well, there was a girlfriend who left me about 50 years ago. Yeah, you got to find some connection somewhere, you know. And I tried to do that. Some personal connection somewhere. For example, in Zoya Akhtar's film, I don't know if you've seen it, it's in Bigina Milegi. I suggested that she add the line where I tell the boy that your hands and mine look alike. And she said, no. So I said, no, I'm going to say this, whether you like it or not. And then she consented, and it's one of the most memorable lines. And I'm not taking the credit for that, but the reason I'm telling you this is that that's the connection I could find. Because I have a daughter who I was estranged from until she was 14. And when I first met her, the first thing that struck me was how much her hands look like mine. So you got to find these connections, I guess. You know, that's what I mean by empathize with the character rather than intellectually.
Thank you so much, sir. Thank you for opening your heart. Thank you for allowing us your wisdom, for sharing your wisdom with us. This was, I think I speak for everyone when I say this was, we're richer as a result of this. Thank you so much. Here's hoping that you will continue to surprise us, excite us, entertain us, work on the stage, on the screen, and hopefully we'll see you here again soon.
You will, absolutely.
Thank you so much.
Absolutely, 100%.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
On behalf of this, thank you so much. I hope you'll both be back again next
we
year.
We will.
We have no garlands and bouquets here to give
thank
you.
Thank God.
So, you know,
we don't do those things.
Yeah. We don't do that.
Yeah, the other painful thing is the shawl. I have a collection of about 50 shawls by now. Thank you all very much.
Thank you.